Good morning. Let us return to the question of isometric action of SL2A on the upper half plane. So one of the claims which we did on the previous lecture, at the end of previous lecture, is that such a quantity is invariant under Möbius transformation on the upper half plane. So let us prove that statement. Fortunately, it's a rather easy calculation, and it will show usage of previous notions. So let us come back to the definition of the inner product which we have, and copy that value, what product of two cycles C and C tilde will be 2 sigma n and tilde minus 2 l l tilde plus k tilde m plus m tilde k. So have it in our hand. And let us discuss what are the values of a cycle associated to a point. We already speak with you about that relation, that if we have determinant of a cycle equal to zero, then in the elliptic case that represents a point. It's a zero radius circle which just shrinks to that point. Let us evaluate exactly what will be such a cycle. So we have a cycle associated to the point in the form u minus l squared plus v minus n squared is equal to zero. So after opening brackets, we have u squared plus v squared minus 2l u minus 2 v n, and that add l squared plus n squared equal to zero. So such a cycle represented by four numbers, one as k, l, n represent the center of the cycle, and value of m will be l squared plus n squared. So let us, according to this rule, to see what is the inner product of two cycles with zero radius. Or maybe we will just start from the other side. Let us see the distance between two points. What is the distance between two points? According, again, to Euclidean geometry and Pythagoras rule. So it's easy to find. So L minus L tilde square root plus N minus N tilde square root. Or if we open brackets, this is L square root minus 2 L L tilde plus L tilde square root plus N square root minus 2 N N square root plus n tilde squared. And what will be the inner product of two such cycles? So we have a cycle which is 1 l n l squared plus n squared times a cycle 1 l tilde n squared l squared plus n squared. So according to the formula which we will use in the elliptic situation with the sigma equal to minus 1, we need to multiply n to n squared, so it's minus 2 n n squared minus 2 l l squared. So then this part coming, but this part is just with k and k tilde equal to 1, will be a sum of m and m tilde. M and m tilde are sum of the squares for L and n. So it's L squared plus n squared plus L tilde squared plus n tilde squared. As you can see, both expressions coincide. So really, d squared, the distance between cycles, between two points, is equal to the inner product of zero radius cycles which represent these points. Right? Okay, so let's make one more calculation. On the previous lecture, we already spoke about that. Real line is a cycle, a straight line, which given by the equation v equal to zero, or that is given as a cycle by coordinates 0, 0, 1, 0. What will be the inner product of a cycle with the real line? So we calculate inner product of any cycle with the real line. So because we have a lot of zeros in the real line, only non-zero term appears where we have n term. So for arbitrary cycle, the inner product would be the expression, which is 2 sigma n. So this is the inner product with the cycle. In particular, if my cycle is zero radius cycle representing the point Ln, then that inner product of cycle 1 Ln L square plus n square with the real line will be again 2 sigma n. Now consider the expression, call it say d capital squared, which is the inner product of two cycles representing zero divided by a product of c with the real line and c tilde with the real line. First of all, we may notice what this expression contains just inner product of cycles, and inner product of cycles is Möbius invariant. So that expression is Möbius invariant by the property of Möbius invariant of inner cycle. Moreover, you shall remember what our cycles are defined up to scalar multiples where point in projective space. If I multiply all coefficient of my cycle by the same lambda, it will be again coefficient for the same cycle. So when we build an expression, we need what that expression to be a homogeneous of zero order with respect to all coefficients. So indeed, we see here what if, for example, we multiply by lambda coefficient of cycle C everywhere in this expression. When we simply have an expression of zero order with respect to lambda, because that lambda and that lambda will be cancelled out. So that definition also correct in this sense. So we have a very well defined expression, which is Möbius invariant. So d squared defined for this cycle C and C tilde, which we considered before for zero radius cycle, will turn out according to our previous calculation, that expression, will be the L minus L tilde squared plus N minus N tilde squared divided by 4 sigma squared N times N tilde. So by the previous calculations, we obtain this expression, which is Möbius invariant zero order homogeneous function of two points Ln Ln tilde. So that is in fact exactly what we have on this presentation. So this is demonstration what we have. Möbius invariant, well-defined function. And furthermore, as we again discussed before, whenever we have a Möbius invariant, any function of Möbius invariant will be a function as well. Invariant will be a Möbius invariant in expression. Now, what we are trying to achieve. So we already discussed a few different definitions what are maybe treated as the straight lines. So we succeeded in building the Möbius invariant distance. So we have this expression. Any function of this expression deliver to us certain distance invariant. So you take non-decreasing function f capital. If you want your distance monotonically increase, you take any non-decreasing function f capital, and then you do superposition of this expression with f capital, obtaining a distance in the upper half plane. Now question is, what would be corresponding straight lines? The straight lines in usual geometry deliver the shortest distance between two points. And that definition may be extended to Riemann geometry. And then in Riemann geometry, there is notion of geodesics, when you calculate the length of all possible curve which join two points A and B, and choose the shortest one. The length is calculated in Riemannian geometry by using the Riemann tensor, metric tensor on this thing. When you geodesics, which is straight line come out on the plane in usual Euclidean geometry. But if you will consider a generic manifold and look for shortest line, shortest curve there, then it will be geodesic, which will be a generalization of straight line. Think, for example, about the sphere, and you put two points on the sphere and look for the shortest curve, then what appears to be geodesics on the sphere are sections of biggest diameter. So then it will provide the shortest curve. That will be the kind of straight lines. And then, for example, physical terms, we have again kind of postulate what light is propagating against along the shortest curve. So in spherical,
which is joining?
No, it's not a straight line. There is no straight lines on the spheres. It's geodesics, and we say geodesics is generalization of the straight line. So this is kind of how we generalize it. And because we want to have a shortest one. we have here some difficulty if we will discuss a situation in elliptic, parabolic, and hyperbolic cases. Because the metric which we use here for the points shall contain really the sigma, so that expression d squared which we use here, it will be minus sigma in this place. If sigma is elliptic minus 1, it's returned to previous expression in elliptic Euclidean geometry, but if we consider hyperbolic geometry, then it will be sigma equal 1, so we have a minus. So essentially in the hyperbolic geometry we have the distance provided by x square minus y square, Lorentz type metric, and the difference between Euclidean metric is what Euclidean metric, the unit ball given by the condition x square plus y square is equal to 1, is convex shape, and a consequence of this is that the we have corresponding triangular inequality. And in particular, we always have in Euclidean geometry absolute value of z plus double u is bounded by absolute value of z plus absolute value of double u. So triangular inequality in the Euclidean geometry. However, in the Lorentz type metric, the equation x square minus y square equal to 1 will produce for us the index shape, which is such hyperbolas. And if we say what in hyperbolic case absolute value of z is square root is x square minus y square, then from index property of unit circle in hyperbolic metric we obtain what z plus double u, so it shall be less or equal, of course, bigger or equal absolute value of z plus absolute value of double u, right? When you see here is two principally in two different in principle situation, we have either index or convex shapes. And this is elliptic and this is hyperbolic. So what shall be the situation for a parabolic one in between? How we may treat it? You see, again, it's crucial for our consideration because if we define straight line in terms of shortest distance, then we may say, okay, for elliptic case we have shortest distance, and then probably for hyperbolic one we need to substitute it by the longest distance. So hyperbolas, which treated as a straight line in hyperbolic case, will deliver the longest possible distance. So you can go obtain any other curve will provide the shorter one. But what happen for parabolic? It shall be in between, between shortest and longest, but what is between? It's opposition. And here come that definition, which is a kind of, again, generalization, which is suitable and cover all it's cover all cases, elliptic, parabolic, and hyperbolic. So let us see why this happen. So it's easy to obtain corollary from the theorems about the longest and shortest distance as follow. If straight line, so I put it in the quote, so straight line here means that not what we think straight line in Euclidean geometry, but straight line in the sense of this variational definition as shortest on longest distance. If straight line deliver, so shortest or longest, if we are working hyperbolic case, distance between any two points when the distance is an additive function. Along the straight line, in the sense what for any point C between A and B, we have the property what AB is equal AC plus CB. So it's clear why this happened, because if I have A and B and assume that property is broken, then I can replace the segment here by another curve and can get either shorter or longer distance depending which we are using here. So just replacing. So if you have that inequality, or other way around saying again, we have here triangle inequalities which can possibly turn into identities. So the known fact, what identity may happen only along points on the same straight line. So triangle inequality degenerate into identity only for points on the same line. So this is somehow a weaker property. It's follow from the variational property, shorter or longest one, but it's weaker. And here, for this reason, because it's weaker, it's suitable for generalization. Because, again, according to Blumenthal, we'll define a line as a curve such for distance is additive, so if that property happen, then what may be the situation? So again, let me use the color code here. Let my straight line will be red. In the elliptic case, the shorter one area with the shorter paths will be drawn in green, and this is anything else. So this is red shortest. It's not the shortest path, this is where points break the so okay, let's use it color code in this way. So if I have the property AB is equal AC plus CB, then I will draw with points in red. If I have AC bigger than CB, then it will be green. And if it's opposite inequality, then it will be in blue. So in Euclidean space, we have that property. So what this is AB. All points C which satisfy to definition of the line will be this point on the straight line. Anything outside will be what provide a point C with longer distance. So if you put a C here, for example, then AC plus CB will be longer, right? So it will be longer. Now this is elliptic one. Now in hyperbolic, we still have that straight lines, again AB, where it's equal, but the rest is a blue one. So here, if I will put a point C outside of straight line, then some of these two lengths will be shorter than AB. So this is blue inequality. And what happened in parabolic situation? In parabolic situation, it's a border line between elliptic and hyperbolic. Can you imagine what will be the border line or so something in between? It's green area from one side and blue on another. So I have exactly identity on the parabolic straight line. If I displace in one side of that straight line, I make my distance shorter. If I will displace to another one, it will be longer. This is what happened in parabolic situation. So as you see here, in parabolic case, we are not able to define the straight line in variational sense. It's not possible to make it strictly smaller than any other path or strictly bigger than any other path. That is possibility which exists in elliptic or hyperbolic case. So we always, for any curve, we always can do it either smaller, both is smaller and bigger. So extreme does not exist in parabolic case. But there is exact identity. There are certain straight line in the sense of Blumenthal along which we have that additivity of the length. So this is what happened in this situation. So let us come to the illustration. So equations, so it's somehow confusing that things if you see it first time. So in hyperbolic, what happened? Well, I draw with red lines as straight lines, but in corresponding geometry it will not be straight lines. It will be arcs of hyperbolas. And so then I just symbolically draw it as a straight line. So just indicate idea what it's a replacement of the straight line. But it will be certain arcs of hyperbolas, right? As in elliptic geometry, Lobachevsky geometry, it will be arcs of the circles. We will see pictures next slide. So we put, as I recall you, so we have basic invariant here of Möbius transformation, and we have a choice what to select as function F capital. Well, it's traditionally in Lobachevsky geometry, it's taken F capital to be inverse hyperbolic sine function. And we will see soon why it's happened. Similarly, we may take in hyperbolic case, if hyperbolic sine was used in elliptic situation, we use elliptic sine in hyperbolic. And in between, there is just, say, identical function times two. So this is our F capital. Now, what will happen when we will draw use such a sine function? So look first to the upper left picture. This is a picture in Lobachevsky geometry. So as we already discussed on the previous lecture, the straight lines in Lobachevsky geometry are these blue semicircles, which are orthogonal to the real line. They are delivering the shortest route between two points with respect to the metric given on the wet theorem. So when we use the distance function f to be inverse hyperbolic sine. So that will be the points along, this will be the straight line. And if so I here draw just straight lines originated at the imaginary units, at the point I. And then green circles here represent the points which are on the equal distance from the I. So in equal distance in the term of Lobachevsky geometry. So that circle has equal distance to I. This is another circle. So as we already said, metric tensor in the sense of Riemann geometry in Lobachevsky geometry has a factor 1 over y. So when you approach the real axis, 1 over y became large, infinitely large. So near to the real line, everything is very long. It has length 1 over y. So as you see, the distance, if I go to the real line, so point on the distance to the real line, became as large as if I go to infinity in opposite direction, away from real line. So this is how geometry in Lobachevsky half-plane is working. So again, so blue half-circles orthogonal to the real axis. This is what shall be straight lines in Lobachevsky geometry. Green circles are the circles which have the same distance to the imaginary unit. So now came to the hyperbolic case. This is two pictures, which are upper right and lower right. So let's look on the upper right. Why two pictures appears here? Because we have, in this case, metric defined by space-time Lorentz type metric. It's t squared minus x squared. And it may be positive or negative. We speak about the time-like and space-like direction. So depending on that sign, is it positive or negative, we have two regions in the light cone. So So we again consider straight lines going from the imaginary unit I, and this straight line can go either in the time-like direction, which is upper right picture, or in the complementary lower right, this is space-like direction. So this is how straight line, blue lines passing I are looking here. So this is hyperbolas of this type, and here is, as you see, hyperbolas of a different type. So this is space-like and time-like. Again, that hyperbolas here deliver the longest possible path. So any if you take two points on hyperbolas and join in by any other path, the length will be shorter. So that is variation principle. For parabolic situation, we have all that things in between. So we may use here the function F capital. So we may use function F capital either as with elliptic situation, inverse hyperbolic sign, or as with hyperbolic situation where usual inverse sine function used, or intermediate value. So if we use situation similar to the hyperbolic one, so the straight line became parabolas this time, and they are focally orthogonal to the real axis. So if you remember that when we considered two types of orthogonalities, first orthogonality and then second focal orthogonality. Focal orthogonality looked much more complicated, and it was question, is it worth to be considered at all or not? So the reason why to consider it is in particular what it appears naturally in various situations. So we obtain so blue lines, if previously it was blue circles in usual sense orthogonal to the real axis, now we have blue parabolas which focally orthogonal to the real axis, and green parabolas here represent points which are on the equal distance from imaginary unit I. And similarly, if we use here, as you see, it's quite similar picture with elliptic case. If we use a sine function as F capital, just a picture will become similar to the hyperbolic one. So as you see here, there are blue hyperbolas which may approach a real axis but never really touch it or intersect. So what happened? In this situation, we similarly have parabolas starting at imaginary unit, URBK, and if you're going along geodesics, as light in physics travel along geodesics, then you cannot go outside of certain region. So here you are bounded by certain region where light is traveling, and situation is same in parabolic one. And this is an intermediate case between elliptic and parabolic one. So again, what I would like to remind you, if initially we spoke about type of geometries which we can just derive for elliptic, parabolic and hyperbolic situation, when we spoke what on the algebraic level, elliptic and hyperbolic imaginary unit just deliver to us what we want. So they more or less working satisfactory. But if we use the parabolic imaginary unit when we have a high level of degeneracy. So, for example, if we start to measure a distance and by similar formulas in the parabolic situation, then we will get just the distance between two points on the complex plane, such that distance between them will depend only from the projection on the real axis. So it's from the x squared. So it's independent on the vertical axis. However, it was algebraic approach based on formal manipulation. But if we work in the spirit of Erlangen program and looked for the Möbius invariant lengths and distances and objects which appears, then the outcome will be much more interesting. So here we obtain non-trivial Möbius invariant distance, which preserved by Möbius transformation, and curves are the corresponding conic sections, parabolas, hyperbolas, and circles. So this is metrical geometry of the upper half plane. Let us also come back to the situation with the from distances to angles. We already discussed several notions of orthogonality, and now having the distance in our disposal, we may define notion of perpendicularity. So you remember, again, in geometry, in Euclidean geometry, we have quite a lot of different connections between various properties. And one of elementary fact of Euclidean geometry is that if you are looking to a shortest distance from a point A to a line L, then you simply need to drop perpendicular from point to the line. That will be your the shortest distance, right? According to the Euclidean geometry. Now, you may ask the following question, what we already used several times. We in Euclidean geometry, this is kind of theorem. So we may turn theorem into definition and say, I have a particular distance in my disposal. So now I able to measure a distance between any two points. So let me take a point, fixed point A and fixed point B. And I would consider a small displacement from B to an arbitrary direction. What is direction of vector CD such what small displacement in either side of CD, either in positive or negative direction along this line, will make our distance longer? So again, in Euclidean geometry, such CD shall be perpendicular. If CD is not perpendicular to AB, then you can go in one way or another a bit and you make your distance shorter. Only if CD is perpendicular, you get the distance longer. Now you may put the same condition for our different type of lengths which we have and ask the similar question. So we have a lot of different lengths which are Möbius invariant or conformal, and you are looking for such a property between vectors which is perpendicularity. And it turned out what this perpendicularity defined in terms of length is coinciding with the focal orthogonality. So the focal orthogonality, which we considered in a couple of lectures before, is exactly the object which delivers that perpendicularity. So as you can see, this is a second place where focal orthogonality naturally appears. So that invariant relation between cycle is of interest, and of some usage in that construction. Finally, a brief discussion about representing the points by means of zero radius cycles. So for circles it's rather straightforward. So we simply shrink the radius of a circle to zero, so we get a point. If we are in hyperbolic situation and we reduce the determinant to zero, when hyperbola shrink to the light cone, we may take the collection of confocal parabolas with the decreasing determinant, and then we will shrink to such half lines, rays starting at given point. So that is again a possibility to represent a point on a plane by a parabola with the small determinant. Probably it's a good place to make a break, and we will have another lecture discussing physical properties of Möbius transformations.